Peace Church and throughout the country government, there's certainly a divide of opinion on what is best in terms of government formation. I worry about that, but of course, the choices are limited.
Both parties' members worry about the impact of the Greens on rural Ireland.
It might impose a lot of restrictions on, I think, people's livelihoods and their activities, particularly land use. So I think that both Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil will worry, or at least they should worry, about the impact that that might have in rural Ireland.
And some grassroots Green members say reducing greenhouse gas emissions by 7% is a red line.
I think 7% is paramount for this country to survive and not be punished severely from Europe. And if we want to get the money from the Green New Deal, we have to show that we're taking that 7% seriously. And that's where the money's going to be coming from.
Roisin Garvey is a Green Party councillor in County Clare.
There has to be a middle ground, because none of us are a dictatorship, none of us are an overall majority. That's why it's called negotiations.
Garvey is keen to get into government.
I just think because of the state of the country at the moment, and it was everyone's interval to power between Fianna Fáil and Gaelic, but at this time we need a stable government to run the country. And I'd rather see the Greens in there playing their part and bringing good policies to the table than being in opposition. But I would not be voting yes or no until I see the outcome of the negotiations, clearly.
But the Green Party worries Fianna Fáil councillor Patrick McGowan and Donegal.
No, let's say it was not Fianna Fáil, any vote it could go 50-50, but it goes to the membership of Fianna Fáil about the entering government was Fine Gael and the Greens. All of the Greens' plans and their policies, they seem to have very little consideration for the needs and wants, and the rights of the people in rural Ireland.
Norma Moriarty, a Fianna Fáil councillor in the Kenmare Municipal District of County Kerry, has similar concerns, but she sees a need to be in government.
Whatever programme of government is put forward, it has to be rural-proofed. I think it's very fair to say that this is a crossroads, but it comes down to a key question. Do you do what's right or what you believe is safest and for your party, or you do what you think is right for the country?
Well, what's more important to you?
The country, Cian. And I sincerely mean that very difficult decisions have to be made.
Fine Gael councillor Bede Roach from Tuam and County Galway has something in common with the Fianna Fáilers.
One of the things that worries me is that the Green agenda might not be favourable to rural Ireland. For the sake of the environment, and I'm very fond of the environment, but for the sake of the environment, we will drive people off the farms, and I worry about that.
But it's on rural Ireland where these similarities end.
The biggest concern I have is that, when they are together long enough, they soon become one. There was a little old lady next door to me many years ago, and she used to have this phrase of saying that if you tie a rabbit and a hare together, they soon turn out to be the same. That's what I worry about, and we will have one party. One will come out very bad out of this marriage, and I hasten to add, I hope it's not a Fine Gael. I think Fianna Fáil, at the minute, are pretty arrogant about their position. They're sitting on 14% nationally. I think Fine Gael have done a remarkably good job.
Would you prefer to have an election?
I genuinely, passionately believe that the general public are much more aware now of what it is that this country needs right now, and they don't want a conglomerate, a concoction of FF, FG and Greens just for the sake of the country. It would be no harm if the people had a choice now.
So sorry, just to be clear, Peter, would you favour an election over going into government at this stage?
I would.
Interesting stuff there from Cian McCormack, and listening to it, Micheál Lehane, it's been such a tough job to get the three-way negotiations going. What are we, 8 weeks later and they're only starting? Listening to that could be an even tougher sell to the grassroots. And can you comment as well on this talk about an election that seems to have certain Fine Gael hearts beating anyway?
Yeah, that does exist within Fine Gael. You don't have to scratch the surface too deeply at all to find it. Equally, there is no one that I've spoken to across the parliamentary party, or indeed at council level either, who can plot you the steps that will be necessary for that election to happen. It seems impossible logistically. I know Brexit was the glue that kept the last government in place for so long, but Brexit in many ways now has been replaced by the COVID-19 crisis as the necessity that will bind a new administration together. And it doesn't realistically seem like there's any way around that, despite a huge desire, not too far beneath the surface within Fine Gael, if they could get that election. I don't think at the highest ranks of the party there is a belief that that could happen, though, and that's why what's going to happen at 4:30 in a room in the Department of Agriculture is fairly significant indeed when the Green, Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil negotiators sit down to begin the talks in earnest, I suppose, about a programme for government.
Micheál, thank you very much indeed for that, Micheál at Leinster House. And now let's go to our Northern editor, Tommy Gorman, because later this afternoon, Tommy, we're going to hear much more about plans to ease the quarantine measures there in the north.
You have a cracker of a bulletin and limited time, so let's spell it out. I don't think there is the secretariat, the experience available to the Northern Ireland executive five-party organisation at this stage to come up with an elaborate plan. I think they'll kick for touch. I think they'll play for time today. They have the template of what has happened south of the border. They're waiting to see what Boris Johnson will officially publish next Sunday. It's the head office that provides the funding. And I'd say they'll be steady as we go, no big changes in what they announced today, and that they'll return to these matters next week.
And of course, as we were hearing earlier in the programme, bank holidays, the movement of people, ports, airports, borders, the police in Northern, PSNI briefing today at 4 o'clock, what might that reveal?
Well, only if people are worried about airports and ports. Truth is, this is a different jurisdiction. There are almost 1.9 million citizens here entitled to travel across the porous border. For a variety of reasons, including the virtual border down the Irish Sea, the mortality statistics north and south are very similar, even though on occasions different policies have been pursued. There is no 2K limitation in place here, or 5K limitation. The police are doing their best to get people to act sensibly. I think the advice from the PSNI will be, please don't be travelling long distances at the weekend, even though it is a bank holiday in Northern Ireland. I think that will be the outcome of the 5 p.m. news conference.
All right, Tommy, thank you very much indeed for that. And those developments will be brought to us later in the day by our Northern editor, Tommy Gorman. After the break, we'll be speaking to campaigner and cancer patient Vicky Phelan, who was urging anyone who thinks they have symptoms that could warrant investigation because of a risk of cancer, she said, whatever your fears about coronavirus, go forward, get checked out. That's after the break.
At Macaulay Pharmacy, we'd like to say a big thank you to our customers for your support and cooperation in these strange times. Thank you to all our dedicated staff and colleagues across the country, making it possible for us to continue to meet your medical needs. We at Macaulay promise to continue serving our local communities when you need us most. Thank you from everyone at Macaulay Pharmacy.
Coronavirus could cost farmers up to €1 billion. In this week's Irish Farmers Journal, we reveal the real impact of coronavirus on farm incomes. Green shoots visible as beef and milk prices rise. Fertilizer and pesticides to be slashed as EU plans organic transformation. €130 million owed to farmers with designated land. And we reveal that the Chagas climate plan will limit cow numbers. Inside this week's Irish Farmers Journal, on sale today, you cannot afford to miss it.
Some of us are anxious. Some of us are learning to video call our grandchildren for the first time. Some of us are clicking refresh endlessly on news sites. Some of us are working on the front line. And some of us are worried about them. And some of us are finding all of this hard. We're all some of us. No matter what you're going through in isolation, let's stay connected and make it through together. Visit gov.ie/together for advice, ideas and support for your physical and mental well-being, an initiative of the Government of Ireland.
Welcome back, you with the news at World. Now, there's been a dramatic drop in the number of patients being referred to cancer diagnostic services since the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, around half the number being referred prior to the outbreak for some of the major cancers. The HSE is appealing to people not to delay seeking medical advice. In the UK, a major study has concluded the coronavirus crisis could lead to 18,000 more cancer deaths because of delayed diagnosis. And I've been talking about that UK study and this whole question with cancer patient and campaigner Vicky Phelan.
Yeah, I'm not surprised, to be honest, Anya. My own oncologist, Professor John Crown, along with some other oncologists, actually have been highlighting the need to balance the need to protect cancer patients like myself and people who may end up getting diagnosed with cancer to treatment and also to early diagnosis for those who present with symptoms. And unlike in the UK where we have this research that's just come out, you know, as far as I'm aware, I don't think we have any real-time data on Ireland in quantifying, you know, the extent of the disruption to cancer services at the moment. There is some anecdotal evidence, obviously, from some specialists. I think I heard about a bowel cancer specialist who was on the radio recently saying that he normally would diagnose up to 8 bowel or rectal cancers per week, and he hasn't diagnosed a single one since March. And I note on the National Cancer Control Programme's press release this morning that there was a GP who mentioned that she would see one breast cancer diagnosis per week, and she hasn't seen any over the last number of weeks, and that's very, very worrying, Anya.
And of course, delay matters hugely, doesn't it, in terms of cancer? I mean, in your case, the delay was nothing to do with your making, but what would you say to people who are delaying going to a doctor about fears they have in their head? And many people, when they find that lump or they notice something unusual, it's a scary thing anyway. They may not necessarily, even at the best of times, want to get the label that they might have.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. And, you know, when I was diagnosed, Anya, actually, at the time when I did find out that I had cancer, I actually went outside of the screening programme. I presented with symptoms, and that's what I would worry about at the moment. You know, at the time when I went with my symptoms, you know, the screening services were operating, you know, the normal services at the time. So I was able to go in and, you know, get my GP to carry out a smear. And my worry is that people are going to leave that at the moment and not present because they're worried, about, you know, going in to see their GP and worrying about getting COVID-19 and maybe thinking that they're over, worrying over something that may not be there. But I mean, when I presented at the time to my GP, I mean, I had no pain. I had a small bit of bleeding, you know, in between my periods. I certainly didn't think I was going to be told I had cancer, but I did. And that's what I would say to people, that if you have any symptoms of any of the cancers, you know, look them up. And I know people tell people not to kind of Google things, but I mean, that is what I did at the time. And I knew my body, and I just knew that something wrong, and presented to my GP. And you know, that is what the HSE is trying to get that message across at the moment, is that people need to go in to see their GP. You know, call, obviously, first, don't present because of COVID. But, you know, call and try and arrange an appointment if you do have symptoms. And if you know your body and this is different, you certainly shouldn't be hanging around and waiting, because, you know, the treatment is there. You know, the National Cancer Control Programme through the HSE has announced that non-COVID services for cancer patients and for diagnosing patients are back up and running from now on. So, you know, definitely to anybody out there, if you have any symptoms of any type of cancer, please do go.
Vicky, everyone's scared of catching COVID-19. What's it like to be somebody living with cancer in treatment? And what's that fear of COVID like?
I suppose I've been very lucky, Anya, that I only go up for treatment every 6 weeks. So I've had one treatment since we've been in lockdown with COVID. And I'm back up again in 2 weeks' time, actually. But I know of other patients who I would meet regularly when I'm up for treatment, who would be in every week or every 2 weeks, and their oncologists have had to, you know, make decisions and benefit kind of the weigh the risks and the benefits of bringing them in every week or every 2 weeks. And in some cases, they've decided to, you know, extend their treatment so they're not coming in as often, and that's going to obviously have an impact on their treatment and on whether or not, you know, tumours may grow back or you know, how they proceed going forward. So it is a huge worry for people. For me, I'm okay, you know, I'm still having my treatment because I only go up every 6 weeks. But it is a huge worry for people who are having treatment at the moment. And I know from the 221 Plus group, actually, you know, a number of women contacted the service to say that they have, you know, the checkups have been cancelled and postponed, and, you know, and people are understandably worried.
And what do you say to people as well about the use of masks and physical distancing from the point of view of people who do have a condition and may be more vulnerable to catching the disease?
Yeah, well, I've been wearing a face mask. My mother made some cotton ones for me. I'm very lucky that I have a mother who can sew. I can't sew at all, thank God my mother can. So she made me a load of cotton masks because obviously, you know, there's no need for people to be wearing medical grade masks. We need to keep those for the frontline staff. But it's very easy to make cotton ones. So, you know, if you have somebody in your family who can make them, you know, I would say go ahead and do it. Or you can wear those snoods, you know, just have one of those scarves that you put up around your face and make sure it's covering your nose. But certainly I've been wearing one for a number of weeks now, not when I'm out walking, social distance when I'm walking and I go out at, you know, late in the evening when there's very few around. But if I'm going into a shop or if I'm going somewhere where there's a crowd, I suppose, I would always wear a face mask. The thing about face masks is, you know, not to touch them at the front. It's a kind of a natural inclination to do that. But make sure that you take it off from the ears, you know, from covering the ears, and not touch your face. And it's very hard to get used to, but I do think it's something that we should all be wearing when we're out in public.
Sound advice from the campaigner Vicky Phelan, who's urging anyone with concerns about potential cancer system symptoms to come forward and have them checked out. Now, finally, Reek Sunday takes place every year on the last Sunday of July, the annual pilgrimage to Kirkpatrick, where thousands of pilgrims climb the mountain in Mayo. Well, this year, due to COVID-19, it could become an all-ticketed affair. Westport Parish priest Father Charlie MacDonald spoke to me before we came on air.
The last thing we would want on Reek Sunday is to in any way contribute to a second wave of coronavirus, or indeed in any way to contribute to even one person being infected. So we have to, I suppose, look very carefully, and that's what we're spending the month of May doing, beginning with seeking public health advice from the HSE and advice from the Gardaí. That will be the first part of the process, and then depending on how that goes, the process will continue on. We hope to have reached a decision by the 3rd of June. So that's what we're looking at as to whether or not the pilgrimage actually will go ahead. We have experience from, I suppose, 2015, when we had to call off the pilgrimage due to weather. How difficult it is, like with most events, you have to open up the venue to allow it to go ahead. In the case of Kirkpatrick, it's open, it will be open at that stage, based on what the Taoiseach announced on Friday night. So you're talking about if it's closed, you're talking about closing down that place. So it's a very different and it's a very unique event. So it has to be, the decision has to be taken quite carefully and cautiously.
What kind of crowds would you typically get for Reek Sunday? I mean, I haven't done it myself, I have to confess.
Sure, yeah,
but I mean, what I've seen on television from the people going up, you know, they look pretty close together.
Absolutely, and these are all things we'll have to take into consideration. First of all, you're talking about 4,000 people over a period of about 13 hours. That's what you're talking about on a normal Reek Sunday. So you're talking about there's a massive up on the hour every hour. So all of that would have to be calculated, all of that would have to be looked at. Initially, first of all, does it meet the criteria for that particular date, the last Sunday in July? Then can social distancing actually be implemented? And if it can't, then there's a problem. So it would involve an awful lot of stewards, it would involve an awful lot of goodwill on the part of those participating. And I suppose for a place that's so open, there's no doubt about it that it would involve limiting numbers. And how that would actually be done, we're not quite sure at the moment.
Could you issue tickets or something?
That's one thing that's been looked at, and then how they will be distributed would have to be looked at as well. So if they were to go ahead, it would quite possibly be something around the lines of issuing tickets. That's probably the way it would have to go. I say we genuinely ourselves do not know at this stage whether or not Reek Sunday is going ahead. It will. The decision will be taken on the best advice available to us in relation to public health. And then when, if we get over the stage of public health, we'll be into the logistics of being able to actually implement all the social distancing guidelines and the best possible practice in relation to being able to have the event. If it does go ahead, we have 2 months to put in place what will be needed.
Any hopes of divine intervention?
We'll take anything we get at this stage. It is going to involve very, very serious conversations in the next few weeks, and it is going to involve serious deliberation, because, as I said at the outset, we cannot in any way be responsible for people being put at risk in any way.
Father Charlie MacDonald there in Westport praying for his Reek Sunday, and that brings to an end the News at One this Thursday. Our editor was Brendan Fitzpatrick, Kieran Cullen was on Sound Lifelines next. So until tomorrow at 1, from all the team, stay safe, good afternoon.
Radio 1.
From the documentary on 1, the doc of the day. Today we recommend No Time to Lose, the story of a young woman who deals with her epilepsy by running.
If you'd met me like 2 years ago, I'd be like a completely different person.
The doc of the day, No Time to Lose. Funded online from RTE Documentary on One or wherever you get your podcasts. Say home, say listening.
My name is Denise Cusick, Community Protection Advisor with Ulster Bank. I specialise in preventing online fraud, helping people avoid scams that try to trick them out of their money. Unfortunately, there's a lot of fraud related to coronavirus, so be aware of emails pretending to be the World Health Organization or fake charities, because right now it's also about staying safe in the online world. Ulster Bank, help for what matters. Ulster Bank Ireland app is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Some of us are eating more than usual at this time. Try to stick to a routine of 3 meals a day and keep snacks to a minimum. We're in this together. For more advice, go to gov.ie/together, an initiative of the Government of Ireland.
We're in this for the love-ins that unite us and the fallouts that tear us apart. We're in this for those moments the whole world's watching. In this for the days you wouldn't believe. And the nights that made us grieve. And we're in this for when we all can gather again. We'll be ready. Classic Sports and RTE. Because we're in this together.
Number I only posted it a few weeks ago, a photograph of myself, not really relevant, but Gay Bourne outside Beauty's back in the day when we used to present the Christmas Eve programme from Beauty's on Grafton Street. And there's Gay up on the balcony, that famous balcony of the famous building. Beauty's has announced they are closing. It's owned by the Campbell Group, and it's over 100 people may have done it because they don't see how they can reopen in the new distancing measures, because anyone who's been in Beauty's lately, and the clippity clappity clatter of cutlery and crockery, knows that it's extremely tight downstairs, and that's part of the atmosphere. People are up close and personal, be it under the Harry Clark windows or near the coffee roasting machine. But anyway, Niamh Hughes, Niamh, good afternoon.
Hi, how are you, Joe?
Good. You want to make a number of points about the closure of Beauty's? Charge whatever rent they want if they can get it, but the building is leased by the RGRE group, which is RGRE Grafton Group, which people will remember from Nam. I think they went down with 2.7 billion debts when the property boom collapsed, and 1.7 billion, which was owed to NAMA, the National and I think Treasury Holdings even owned the building that NAMA are now based in. But anyway, this is a comment from Beauty's, just to give people a historical. Beauty's last year withheld its rent for the second quarter, which resulted in receiving a 21-day statutory demand from the landlord, threatening to wind up the company for non-payment. Beauty's chief executive last November said losses at the Grafton Street Cafe, which near 1.5 million annual rent, which he describes as excessive and a legacy from the Celtic Tiger boom. Following the crash in 2008, Bewley's fought an unsuccessful campaign to have the rent cut in half to 725 effectively, which had been suggested by a third party arbitrator. And the cafe has been subsidised, according to Bewley's, in recent years by the wider group, Bewley's group. And this is a statement from Johnny Ronan's company. We are saddened and surprised by the news that the iconic Bewley's Cafe in Graftry is to close, especially as we attempted to engage with the Campbell family over the last few weeks to reach a mutually acceptable outcome after the company declared that it was taking a rent holiday. Preferred solution has always been for Bewley's as a Dublin institute, which belongs on Grafton Street, to reopen its doors as soon as it can. However, the Rowan Group has made it clear to Bewley's on numerous occasions that we are not in a position to subsidise its business when its shareholders are perfectly capable of doing so. Bewley's is a successful and profitable company and has generated significant earnings for its shareholders over the period of many years. We call on the Campbell family to enter into meaningful dialogue with the Rowan Group to see if this unfortunate outcome can be avoided. Now, that would be interesting. I presume that's the imprimatur of Johnny Ronan saying we are willing to talk. Now, the other context of this video that started circulating, two videos actually in the last few days, circulated by the photographer Páirc O'Loughlin, but he's an investigative journalist as well, and it's apparently it was made in